Don't try to sneak into your room like that. I know what you've got behind your back. Records. More new records.
So now, let's get to the issue at hand that's created this big brouhaha over the past week or so. So, about 2 weeks ago, well, let's go back to the original Thriller press release. Mobile Fidelity sent me a link to a press release prepared by the estate of Michael Jackson, who some of you know I had a tussle with a couple of years ago when I was called as an expert witness in the trial of Quincy Jones versus the estate of Michael Jackson regarding the use of master tapes. The press release was sent to me. I clicked on it. It was an online thing, and it said, and I wish I had taken a screenshot, but I didn't think I had to. It said, Bernie Grundman to cut 40th anniversary Thriller CD from the master tapes, or Bernie Grundman to use master tapes to whatever. Bernie Grundman's name was in the headline, and it said master tapes, and he's cutting it for the CD 40th anniversary reissue. I swear to you, it was in that headline. And then four or five paragraphs below, it said, and Mobile Fidelity Sound Labs will be releasing a 40,000 run of their one-step process vinyl. And I immediately said to myself, well, how are they going to do that? And I wasn't the only one. I got emails from people. How are they going to do that? If each lacquer gives you 1,000 copies, they got to run that tape 40 times. What can they possibly use? So I speculated responsibly. And I said, well, it could either be Bernie's going to, for the first time, Bernie's going to cut lacquers for them for this. And, you know, because this press release came from the estate of Michael Jackson, they're in super control of the whole thing. There could be variations in all of this. It's reasonable to think that. And so it was, maybe it could be Bernie's going to cut 40 lacquers, and maybe he'll make a copy of the master tape and make the lacquers that way. Or maybe Bernie will make a copy of the master tape, which he will have in his possession, and he will send it to Mobile Fidelity, and they'll cut lacquers from that. Or maybe Bernie will send them the high-resolution digital file, and they'll cut from that. And I posted that on my under my posting of the part of the press release. And I did that in part because I've been burned before where it'll say mastered from the original analog tape, and I'll put that up and say, this is mastered from the original analog tape. And it turns out it's not, because you know the labels are kind of screwing with us a lot. And what they do is they say, oh yeah, it's mastered from the original analog tape. But what that means is we digitize it, and then it's cut. I had that problem with the George Harrison Old Things Must Pass, where I said, this is going to be AAA, because they said to me it's mastered from the original analog tape. And of course it wasn't. So I don't want to get that kind of crap ever again, so I'm careful. So this time, and I wanted to get this up immediately, because, you know, with breaking news like Thriller coming out again, you really want to be the first on the block to have it. I'm sorry. And so I put it up there. Immediately I heard from MoFi, and they said, Michael, take that down. That's just speculation. We got a copy of it. Now, here's where the first bone of contention is. I am absolutely certain I heard we're using a tape copy, but we're not going to announce it until after the Munich Hi-Fi show. Then why was it such a big deal for me to leave that speculation up there that it was going to be a tape copy or a digital file? Why was that a problem? Why couldn't that have remained up? Why was it such a big deal? I don't know. Never got that answer. But I know that I called somebody immediately after that conversation before I went to the Munich show. And I said, I just heard from, because he had said to, this person had said to me, how's that, how are they going to do that? And this is a person in the business. How are they going to do 40,000 copies? And I called him back and said, oh, I just heard they're using a copy of the tape. And he corroborated that. You said copy of the tape. But it doesn't really matter. What matters is I started getting comments under that story from readers saying, hey, Fremmer, you're hallucinating. Maybe it's time for you to hang it up. Bernie Grundman's not even in the headline. Bernie Grundman's not even in that press release. Where'd you get Bernie Grundman from? And I go back to the press release, and Bernie Grundman was gone. And I'm telling you that Bernie Grundman, who mastered Thriller originally and mastered every other reissue of it, and said in a video recently that he cut it 100 times from the master tape, Bernie Grundman's name, this is like the Twilight Zone, Bernie Grundman's name was in that headline, but now it was scrubbed. crazy stuff. Now we're just getting to the crazy stuff. All right, so I go to Munich, and Nagra asks me to bring a bunch of good records and play them in their room on their new turntable and do a dog and pony show and tell. And I love doing that. I love playing I love playing records with people when I was a disc jockey on the radio and I had the all-night slot on WBCN on weekends. I love that because that's when needy people are not out dating. They're all by themselves in their room and they're feeling sorry for themselves. And I can relate to that from my period of time when I was that age, a kid. And I love playing records with people. So, and I've done that at shows, and it's the most fun. So I bring records to Nagra, and I do the Dog and Pony Show. And the guy from Nagra comes up to me afterwards, and he says, "I'll remember that for the rest of my life." He actually said that. It was very, very sweet of him to say that. And I did the same thing at the Martin Audio Room a couple of years earlier for all the international distributors. And after it was over, the Israeli distributor came up to me and said, "I'll remember that for the rest of my life." And it was a nice thing, you know? Anyway, after that event was over in the Nagra Room, one of the guys from Nagra came out with their social media guy came out with a camera and put it up and said, "Michael, that was incredible. Tell us about yourself." That was the question. So I answered. I told them about myself. And they put it up on, the Absolute Sound put it up on their YouTube channel. And the first, one of the comments was, "It figures. You put the camera on Fremmer and all he does is talk about himself." I mean, that was what they asked me to do. So I responded to him. I said, "You know what? It's lucky they asked me about me. Because if they asked me about you, there would be absolutely nothing to say."
Okay.
I get back from Munich. Nothing from Mobile Fidelity about Thriller. And frankly, at that point, it was off my radar. I didn't care about it. Then, a couple of weeks ago, I get a message from somebody, and I'm not going to say who this was, and he says, "Here's breaking news. Mobile Fidelity is cutting all of their one steps and all of their stuff since 2016 from high-resolution digital files. A guy who works for MoFi, who's the deep throat of MoFi, is going to come out and talk about this. What do you think of that?" I said, why a guy would sacrifice his job to talk about something like that, even if it's true, I don't understand. But you know what? I can't engage in rumors. That's a rumor, and it's a third source rumor. I heard it from you, who heard it from this other guy, and that's just too far. And other people can do that, but I'm not going to do that. And I didn't.
And then...
I start getting accused of, "You're covering up for Mobile Fidelity. Why are you covering up for Mobile Fidelity?" I said, "I'm not covering up for anybody. I am not indulging and engaging in rumor mongering." So, this brouhaha goes on. I send a letter, and I have that email, and if you want to see it, I'll send it to you, to Jim Davis at MoFi. And I said, "Jim, you have a problem here. You got to get ahead of this problem because all these rumors are flying around that you're cutting from digital. And I don't know whether it's true or not, but you ought to get on top of this and do something about it." So then in all this brouhaha where MoFi is cutting from digital files, I get a messenger call from someone. And he says, "Listen, I know that MoFi can cut from analog tapes because I help them with an analog tape." And at this point, you know, I'm letting it all hang out. I don't really care because this all has to come out. So the guy that called me is Jamie Hayworth from Plangent. Plangent is this system. Some of you know if you've heard the Bruce Springsteen box, which sounds phenomenal. It's a system that once you digitize a file, he takes it and puts it through his algorithm, and he can lock onto the tape bias, the high-frequency tape bias that's on the tape. It gets transferred to the digital domain, and you can see all the ripples in the speed fluctuation, speed error, scrape flutter, and other anomalies that exist in tape. Nobody says tape is perfect. You know, let's get over this idea that tape is perfect and digital's bad. No one says that, and there's a cartoonish viewpoint of all this. Tape has its problems, digital has its problems. But his process can lock onto the tape issues and fix them in the digital domain, and you end up with a much better product. Well, it turns out, according to him, and he's the first-hand source, Mobile Fidelity got the original master tape of Dire Straits' Love Over Gold. They digitized it, as they do, which he thought was going to be for their SACD, because he didn't know the process either, and they cut lacquers, and there was a problem with their playback deck, and there was a wow, or flutter, or something, a really grossly audible, and they had to do something about it. Now, they could have gotten the tape back. They had sent the tape back to Warner Brothers. They could have gotten the tape back, and, you know, honestly, they should have. I don't know what you think, but I think when you know, if you're going to make records that are supposed to be special, you go back, and you get the tape, and you do it over again. But they didn't do that, okay? According to him, and this is a first-person source, because he was involved, he fixed it. He fixed the file and got rid of all the speed anomalies and sent it back. They never gave him credit, which they should have. But if they did that, you'd know it wasn't cut from an analog tape. And the record came out, and guess what? The record sounds fantastic. It sounds fantastic in part because it was plunged and processed. And because it was already digitized. And you know what I think? I think if you're going to release all of your records from digital files, guess what? You should get the plunging process involved in it because it's really, really good. Now, if they tried it and didn't like it, they could say so, but they're not talking because they were covering up what they were doing. But if you're using digital files to cut records and you've digitized the tape already, I think it makes sense to make the best possible record out of that digital file. You send it up there, and you get plangent process involved in it. It's still the same digitization. It's still your file, but it fixes the anomalies in playback. All right. So look, after all this nonsense that went on, MoFi invites Mike Esposito from InGroove to go up to Sebastopol and get the story. And he finally manages to get the story and dig it out, get it out of these guys. And, you know, he's right. It wasn't really their job to defend what they're doing because they're doing what they're doing. It's what they believe is good, which is fine. But who really needs to defend what they're doing are the marketing people and the people who are writing the things that are being published about from master tapes and all analog and whatever else they're saying. But we're all happy that Mike got the facts out of Mobile Fidelity, but a lot more needs to be done. They've really got to come clean about the entire process. And one of the things I found interesting is they said, Mike had said in his video he got to go back to the back of the place, and they have the Beatles box prototypes, and they've got all of this memorabilia of the whole history of the company. But then when he asks, what about, how do we know what titles were done from what? We'll have to try to figure that out. You mean they didn't keep a log? It's hard to believe they don't have a log of how they produced each title. I mean, there are probably good reasons why you'd want to have a log for each title. I know I once went to Rudy Van Gelder's studio for something, and Don Sickler, who was kind of running the studio now with his wife, took out a piece of paper, and he read for us every session that was ever recorded at Rudy Van Gelder's studio on the particular day we were there every year going back in the past. And the list was amazing, and these were records that you've certainly heard. I just find it hard to believe that MoFi does not have a list, that the guys, when they made these records, when they were in there mastering these records, they don't have source and date and process for each production. I hope they do. And they should expose that. I mean, ultimately, you could say it doesn't matter, only matters how it sounds. But that's really not so. Everybody that buys these records is entitled to know what they're buying. We finally got the information out that it was from digital. And in all honesty, Mobile Fidelity has a black eye over this. I knew way back that they could not get Sony tapes to Sebastopol. Sony tapes only went to Sterling Sound, and they don't even go there anymore. Sony will not send out any more tapes, which really sucks. So when they release stuff from their tapes, they digitize them, and you get a digital remastered record. They won't give the tapes out. This is how the major labels screw everything up always, eventually. As long as there's no money involved, they don't care. You want my tapes? Take my tapes. Bernie, you want my 3-track Kind of Blue? Yeah, take it. It's no problem. Once they see there's money involved, they screw it all up, and it's really sickening. Oh, one more thing I wanted to tell you, and I'll get back to this. So they did a Bitches Brew, and there was speculation, what did they cut this from? You know, the master tape was apparently in really bad shape on this, and what did they use? Well, guess what? The master tape of this is in great shape, because I held it in my hands, and I heard it. In 2010 at Sterling Sound, they did an all-analog transfer for I forget who, but I'll show a picture, I'll put a picture up here, of the original analog master tape in around 2010. I heard the playback, and it sounded phenomenal. So I assume that they used that and not some kind of remix. They didn't have to use the remix. All right, now, the one-step situation. Here's what it says here. I'm going to read it to you. MFSL engineers begin with the original master tapes and meticulously cut a set of lacquers. To me, that's pretty clear. Mobile Fidelity gets the master tape and cuts a set of lacquers. It means what it says. Yeah, okay, you could fudge it. It's not right.
This was,
you know. And they know it now. They know it. And they're going to get more transparent, and that's what they have to do. And yes, ultimately, what matters is how it sounds and how it sounds to you. And I'm still not convinced that a DSD file is the best way to cut a lacquer when there's a tape. There are tape, and you know, yes, in that video they danced around and said, yes, well, if you have 12 different tracks cut at 12 different recording studios, then, you know, you have to transfer each one because you got to set the azimuth, you got to check the levels, you can't just produce a running master. And if you make a copy of each one and assemble a running master from tape copies, you're going to lose something. Well, you may lose something, yes, but you also lose something when you digitize it. It's not transparent. And anybody out there that thinks that digitization is digital is transparent, you can't hear it. Every analog to digital converter in the world sounds different from one another. And every studio has their own preferences because they all sound different. And 9624 sounds different than DXD, which is 330 hertz and 32-bit. They all sound different. Everything sounds different. Your speakers sound different with different cables, I'm sorry to tell you. Everything makes a difference. And you have to decide, when you're mastering, what makes the most sense. And sometimes, digitizing separate reels of tape does make sense. Other times, I've heard stories of master tapes of compilations that were actually spliced together, and each track had different azimuth and different levels, and two people sat there while they cut the lacquers. One guy was on the azimuth adjustment of the head, and one guy was on the levels, and they went through these tapes and did a dress rehearsal and cut it and changed it as they went. And they got a lacquer cut from the original tape without digitizing. There's a lot of different ways of solving problems, and digitizing is one way of doing it. Okay, and now, two more things. Someone sent this to me today, and this is from Mobile Fidelity Customer Service, October 9th, 2020, and I'm going to read it. It's right here. Thank you for your email. There is no analog to digital conversion in our vinyl cutting process. That's from their email. Customer service, Mobile Fidelity Sound Labs. That's just not true. We know it's not true because they finally admitted it. This has been a debacle for Mobile Fidelity. I've been a fan of this company since Herb Belkin days, and I'm still a fan of the company, and I don't think the guys that were in that video yesterday are the villains in this. No one's a villain in this, except somebody was not straight with you. That's the problem. Somebody was not straight with you. And I've been assured by Mobile Fidelity yesterday that they are going to straighten this out. They're going to come fully, fully clean. And that going forward, they're going to tell you what they're doing on every single release. Which is what should have been done starting when they were doing this. And the back of the record says ultra analog on it. And it wasn't. And they could make a case for why the digital file is better than cutting a straight lacquer. The best way to make that case would be to cut both ways using the same chain and the same tape. Get a master tape that we all know and love. We should do a GoFundMe. We'll pay for it. Get a master tape in. Cut a lacquer straight across, all analog. Then digitize it the way you do it. Plange and processor are not involved. And put it out. And we'll pay for it. And let us decide what we hear. And then we can make our decisions as informed customers. So that's all I have to say about this subject. And I really hope that MoFi will come clean. And I'll tell you one last thing. It's unbelievable. So I've done a couple of videos with Michael Ludwigs in Germany. And his glasses are thicker than mine, which I'm very jealous of. I think he's a good player in all of this. He's an honest guy. He buys all of his records. If you think getting promos, you know, has kind of put me on the gravy train and you know. At any rate, it's ironic. Do you know what his job is? He has an advertising agency, a big one, and he specializes in marketing and crisis management. I mean, could you come up with something more bizarre than that? Ironically, they could hire him to help solve this debacle. And the last thing I'm going to say is, as in Watergate, for those of you who remember that, the cover-up is always worse than the crime. And that's all I have to say about this subject, and I'm done. Thank you for watching.